Hello, my name is Grant Hendry. I'm a pastor at North Beach Baptist Church, and it's my privilege to be able to answer a series of questions that came in after a sermon last Sunday on Mark chapter 4, verses 1 to 35. So Mark 4, verses 1 to 35 have a series of four different parables, starting off with the most famous of all parables, or just about the most famous of all, namely the parable of the sower and the seed. So a whole lot of questions have come in. It's going to take a while to get through these questions, but it's a privilege to be able to open the scriptures and just be able to talk through some things. So sit back and relax and let's engage with some of these questions. So the first question that came in is, how does the second seed of Jesus' parable of the sower relate to the teaching that may or may not be biblical of once saved, always saved? Well, this is a great question. So the parable of the sower, of course, has different seeds and they grow or not grow. And then we draw some implications from that. Indeed, Jesus does for us and forever, a profound parable. And which of those seeds relate to people who are saved and which of those seeds relate to people who aren't saved. So let me just unpack the question a little bit and then go back specifically to the parable and to parables full stop, actually. So the doctrine of once saved, always saved, it's a hot potato in many circles. We want to believe it, but is it true? You know, we want to believe it because for our own security of salvation, we want to believe it, and also for the security of salvation of loved ones that we have, that may have made a profession of faith and yet have wandered away from faith. And we've all got friends and family, I think, that have fit into that category. So let me unpack a little bit of the doctrine of the security of salvation, which the question says, you know, may or may not be true. Well, on Sunday, we also had a baptism. And in that preparation or the discussion leading up to the baptism, I quoted Romans 5. And Romans 5 is a classic passage where it talks about when we're sinners, rebels against God, ungodly, powerless to do anything about it, God intervenes and saves us. And as a consequence of that, Paul argues, now that we've been transformed by God's love from enemies, sinners, rebels, to people who are at one with God, how much more can we be sure that God's going to keep on loving us? So Romans 5 actually is pointing us in the direction of security, of salvation, once believer, always a believer. But of course, it's not just Romans 5 that points us in that direction quite clearly. In John 3, verse 15, for example, it states that whoever believes in Jesus Christ will have eternal life. And if you believe in Christ today and have eternal life, then clearly, once saved, always saved. Because if you believe in God today and have eternal life, you can't not believe in God tomorrow and not have eternal life. Can you see that it wouldn't be eternal life that you have today if that was the case? So John 3, and of course, looking at the whole of the chapter, gives us more indication there that if you lose your salvation, the promise of eternal life would be an error in the scriptures. Romans 8, verse 30 declares that those he, God, predestined, he also called, and those he called, he justified, and those he justified, he glorified. And so that reveals that from the moment God chooses us, it's as if we're glorified in his presence. And there's this sort of, like, you come to faith in Christ, there's a yet and not yet kind of tension, we call it, that a heavenly reality comes. Colossians actually is a great book that also reveals this, that we actually, at the point of conversion, there's sort of this heavenly reality where our spirit is raised to heaven, but our body is still here. And so, yes, we are saved, and yes, we will be saved in a definitive and complete way, where we're free from all of the implications of our sinful bodies and our sinful world and our frailty that we have at the moment. So there's a whole host of scriptures that reveal once saved, always saved, and predestination, and we see that in Ephesians as well as Romans, is a doctrine that would actually conclusively reveal that as well. And I'm not so talking about me and what I have to say about predestination, but the scriptures use the word predestined and predestination, and the truth is you can't be predestined for a certain period. So Grant Hendry is predestined to be a believer from 1980 to 2024, but after 2024 he's not predestined anymore. You either are or you're not predestined. You either are or you're not elect. And these are words that are used in the scriptures. Once a person is justified, their salvation, I absolutely firmly believe in, have a great conviction. The scriptures are pointing in this direction. Our salvation is guaranteed. Let's go back to Romans 8 for a second. Romans 8, 38. And I think this is probably the most conclusive proof in answer of this. Romans 8, 28. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angel nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. That's pretty clear. Paul gives a shot. Is there anything that's going to be able to take away my salvation? My life? My eternal life? The answer is no. So I affirm, once we're saved, we're always saved. Our salvation is eternally secure. But what about people that we know of who have made a profession of faith and they no longer believe? And I say, friends, leave it in God's hands and don't give up hope. And don't give up being prayerful for people like that. It's a terrible thing to not be walking with the Lord Jesus. And so we want to pray and discuss, debate, journey, encourage, help anybody who's not walking with Jesus to come to trust Jesus. And if it's a come back or a come to for the first time, that's so clear of what it is important for us to do. So what about the parable? Because this question was asked in the context of Jesus' story about the sower and the seed. And so there's four different kinds of seed in the sower and the seed. There's seed that's snatched away, doesn't grow, never germinates. There's seed that does germinate and withers very quickly, so it doesn't have any root, so it dies pretty quickly. It's just a seedling. There's seed that grows and it just doesn't produce the fruit because it's in competition for light, nutrients, water and everything else because of the weeds that are overtaking it. And there's a good seed which grows and produces a great deal of fruit. Now, I want to sort of give a bit of an understanding about parables here. Parables are stories, earthly stories with heavenly meanings, and over the centuries, people have taken parables in different ways. So if you go to St. Augustine, for example, is a famous, very influential and very significant theologian in the early church, who took parables and sort of tried to make every part of the parable speak of a truth. So he allegorized every single part of parables and came up with some weird and wonderful and bizarre contextual interpretations that would not make any sense to us now, and it just quite clearly can't be what Jesus is saying. And so people have worked through the parables and looked at how Jesus interprets parables and say, well, actually the point of a parable really is to make a point. It's not to make zillions of points and to allegorize it so that they can sort of specifically refer to all sorts of different people. A parable really makes a central point. Now, there might be multiple points, but the fact is, when Jesus tells a story, he's not saying every part of his story is there to actually teach us diverse, eclectic truths. He tells a story to nail something. And in the case of the parable of the sower and the seed, is nailing the whole reality that lots of people hear the truth and many turn away from life-giving eternal truth, reject it, and Jesus is explaining that that's how it always will be. It's how it will be now, just as it was when Jesus was there. So that's quite clearly the point of why Jesus is telling this parable. And he's also revealing, and the next three stories about life-giving truth, you know, light that shines, but also seed, mustard seed, and the other stories about growing seeds, reveal that Jesus is talking about the wonder and the marvel of new life that replicates. And so there is actually, I think this parable is more complex. It's not just a single point. It's pointing about the power of the gospel, and it's revealing the importance of being fruitful as a believer. But they're all closely related. It's not allegorizing, closely related truths. So it's basically making one slightly diverse point that Jesus is doing here. So let's just unpack it very, very quickly. The seed that was snatched away, clearly not regenerate, not a believer. It's somebody who hears the gospel and just gone, not doing anything with it, and Satan's active in snatching away the seed so the person doesn't think again. The seed that germinates and withers as a seedling, is that a Christian who hears the gospel and truly becomes a believer but doesn't last very long? And the seed that germinates and doesn't produce fruit, is that somebody who's clearly a Christian because of the germination, but they're not producing fruit? And then the final kind of seed, the seed that germinates and produces multiple grain, 30, 60, 100 fold of what it was as the seed, as the kernel. In the sermon, I sort of indicated that the seed that's described as the seed that's got the competition with weeds, that could well be a believer who's been distracted by the pleasures of this world. That's what Jesus talks about, and so he's a true believer, but is an unfruitful believer. And I guess in this context, I want to unpack it a little bit more, is that all that we can say with certainty is that the good seed, the seed that produces 30, 60, 100 fold, is clearly regenerate Christian. And whether or not the seed that's strangled by weeds is a true Christian or not, it's a travesty, it's a tragedy, it's a horrible thing for a Christian to not be fruitful. Make sure you're not that. That's the point of the parable. Don't be that. Whether that person's a Christian, a genuine Christian, but they're not fruitful or not, is not the point of Jesus. It's not what he's making. And same with the seed that withers because it doesn't have any root at all. I mean, the implication is that they're not a believer at all. But we're not to drill into this parable and say, well, there was spiritual life because it did grow, even if it just grew a few centimetres. That's not the point that Jesus is making. The point that Jesus is making is some people will hear the truth and they will reject it for diverse reasons. But there will be some who will hear the truth and will be shaped by it. And that's clearly shaped for all eternity. And so I just want to say, yeah, there's complexities to the parable, but make sure that we're not playing with fire here, that we are being what God has called us to be as his followers, is people who are fruitful. And by being fruitful, that means telling others about the Lord Jesus, showing fruit in our actions, in our goodness, but most of all, in our faith, locking in, trusting the Lord Jesus, and gossiping the gospel, telling the great news of the Lord Jesus to everybody we come across. That's what we're called to be, and that's what the privilege of being a Christian is. And so I hope there's some extra clarity that's come through that. Long-winded answer, but it's a great question. Next question. Are there more kinds of seed than the four that Jesus mentions? Okay, so let's head back there. Four kinds of seed, the seed that snatched away, withered, and the weed competition seed and the good seed. You know what? My first reaction to this question is yeah, of course there's all kinds of other kinds of seed that Jesus, he could have talked about a fifth kind of seed, for example, a seed that germinates, it doesn't have competition, but it just doesn't do much, you know, a bit like some tomatoes that Marie and I planted years ago, and every tomato bush produced one cherry tomato. And I think, you know, well, that's not really exactly being fruitful, is it? And I haven't planted tomato bushes ever since because of that. Now, what I'm getting at is my initial reaction is, yeah, there could be other kinds of seed. Jesus could have added a fifth kind of seed, you know, a seed that just doesn't produce much, even though it doesn't have competition of weeds. But do you know what? The more I've reflected on this, the more I've thought, actually, Jesus is really, really comprehensive. You know, seeds snatched away, seeds that germinate but just do nothing, seeds that have a competition with things and therefore are not fruitful, and good seeds that are fruitful. I think Jesus is nailing all the different kinds of response to the gospel. There's many different causative reasons, like there's lots of things that we can be sidelined by, but I'm quite convinced that Jesus' point is that if we're not producing fruit, if we're not showing the fruit of the Spirit, you could use as another metaphor in the scriptures, if we're not producing grain, if we're not living and speaking and sharing God's truth, we're not being what God has called us to be. As a Christian, I've got this immense joy and privilege and responsibility. Nothing else makes sense than to dig into God's word, put a root down, a deep root down that makes me fruitful. And so drilling back into the answer really of the last question is the joy and the privilege of a Christian is to be a good seed that produces abundantly. And let's not play with anything else. Let's be shocked, let's be pushed, let's be pulled, let's be encouraged to ensure that that's the kind of seed that we are as a follower of the Lord Jesus. So that was a great question. Let's just march forward. The next question is actually a question about prayer. And I'll read the question. Should our prayers simply be to praise the Lord's glory and thank him that his will is being done? I can't think just at the moment of where particularly that was raised in the sermon about prayer, but I'm eager and always happy to talk about the significance of prayer. And hey, let's talk about kinds of prayer. So the question is, should our prayer simply be to praise the Lord's glory and thank him for his will, that his will is being done? Let me give a snapshot of prayer in the scriptures. The Bible reveals that there's many, many different kinds of prayer. And for example, in 1 Timothy chapter 2, it says, first of all, I urge you that you pray, and pray in a certain way, with supplications, prayers, intercessions, thanksgivings for all people. And so there's multiple different prayer words used sequentially in 1 Timothy chapter 2. So that is revealing there are different kinds of prayer. And as you keep on working through the scriptures, you know, James talks about praying in faith, the prayer of faith. The prayer of faith will save the one who is sick, and the Lord will raise them up. In that context, prayer offered in faith for somebody who is sick, they'll be healed if in accordance with God's will. There's prayers of thanksgiving, where to pray with thanksgiving to God. May your requests be known to God with thanksgiving, Philippians 4 verse 6. And there's lots of examples of thanksgiving prayers in the Psalms. And supplication is a word that we don't use much these days at all. It's actually a request, you know, prayers of request, praying, Lord, will you please do such and such? Will you please do A, B, C, D? And they can be prayers for us and prayers for others too. And the scriptures say, pray like that. I mean, our Heavenly Father wants to bless his children. It's not saying making us wealthy and healthy and taking away all of our problems, but our Father, just like any good earthly father, wants to bless their children and provide for their needs and to know the needs, which means that the child needs to tell the father certain needs. That's God, our Father, is a good father, is a good father. Even that's not strong enough. He's our perfect, loving Heavenly Father. And so in Philippians 4 verse 6, we are exhorted, don't be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication or prayer and requests with thanksgiving, let your requests be known to God. Now, God knows our needs already, but as a relationship, he wants us to want him to intervene. He wants us to ask him to give good gifts to his children, to us as his children. And part of winning the spiritual battle that we're in is to pray in the spirit, pray in step with God's purposes, praying with a confidence that God will intervene according to his purposes, and an eagerness to seek blessing from God. Knowing that we are not God, so we do not always know what to pray for. Romans 8 actually talks about another kind of prayer, a prayer of groans, which is sort of revealing to us that sometimes we just even don't know how to pray, but it's just a dependence upon God to ask for his intervention. And Lord, I don't know how to pray, but please intervene, have your will. Sometimes we can be that vague because we can't be more specific. We just don't know how to pray. In Ephesians 6:18, just talks about, you know, praying with all sorts of requests for things of God. And there's prayers of worship, where we just simply bow before the Lord Jesus and say, I honor you, I worship you, I trust you. I come before you to acknowledge your greatness, my smallness, your infinite love, my so inadequate love. I bow before you and just acknowledge that you are perfect and I am not. And I rejoice in your goodness and how you are. This prayers of commission, prayers of dedication. When Paul and Barnabas were there in Antioch, people were praying in worship to God, and the Spirit spoke to the church in Antioch as they were worshiping God. We read in the scriptures, and told them, set aside Paul and Barnabas to go. And they went on the first missionary journey, and they prayed a prayer of commission and dedication, just like we do. We prayed for Baron as a pastor just a few weeks ago, and we will pray for Anton as a pastor just commissioned just recently in the church here at North Beach. And so prayers of commission. And so there's a whole host of different kinds of prayers. Prayers of intercession, many times our prayers include requests for others as we intercede for them. In 1 Timothy chapter 2, Jesus serves as our example in this area as well, in John 17, where Jesus is interceding for his followers, his immediate disciples and later followers of the Lord Jesus, including us. The Bible speaks of praying in the Spirit in 1 Corinthians 14, verses 14 and 15. I said about 18 about Romans 8, where prayers, we don't even have the right words. And of course, prayer is a conversation with God, where we're revealing our trust and our need for God to intervene according to his purposes. But the scriptures never promise that all of our prayers will be answered in accordance with what we ask, and it would be a disaster. It'd be dangerous to pray if that was the case, because our perfect Heavenly Father knows exactly what we need. Our perfect Heavenly Father knows everything. We know almost nothing, the smartest, most godly person knows so little in comparison to what God knows. And so even the smartest, most godly person, and that is not me, the smartest, most godly person does not always know how to pray, and will sometimes pray for things where God looks down, is pleased by our prayerfulness, but he says, you know what, I'm going to answer that prayer in a different way to how you're prayed, because I've got something better. All things work together for the good of those who love God. And so sometimes we don't ask for good things, but God will answer our prayers according to what is good. John Stott said that if God answered every prayer exactly the way he prayed, that he would never pray again, because he knew his own frailty, that he often asked God for things that aren't good, even though he didn't know what was good. So not all prayers are answered. The Apostle Paul, the great Apostle Paul, you know, the famous passage in 2 Corinthians 12, where he talks about praying three times for a thorn in his flesh to be removed from him, and it wasn't. And so the great Apostle Paul, even in his prayerfulness, he was earnest and sincere and faith-filled in his prayer, without a doubt. But it was not always answered, and not even for Paul. And so I'm guessing that the question about prayer may have actually come out of a prayer that I prayed for Ben as he was being baptized. So Ben shared his testimony about, and we're going to talk about this in another question that's come up. Ben shared his testimony, and in the water, I put my hands on Ben and I prayed for him. And I'm going to tell you and unpack a little bit of what I prayed for Ben and a little bit of why. I actually prayed a prayer of commissioning for Ben. It just testified, using words and using actions in baptism, to his faith in the Lord Jesus. And I commissioned him to fruitful evangelism. Perhaps, I don't want to be super spiritual here, I just want to say, perhaps you could even say, I commissioned Ben to be an evangelist. And Ben shared some of his story about a physical issue with his back and his hips. And I said, Lord, please heal Ben. Now, I don't know if God's going to heal Ben, but I prayed in faith that God would heal Ben physically. And yet, the greatest thing that's ever happened to Ben was that he was healed spiritually. And Ben's love for Jesus was overflowing in his words and in his actions and his gratefulness to God bringing about all that he brought about so that he met the Lord Jesus through reading the scriptures. And so I did pray a prayer of commission for Ben as an evangelist. I prayed a prayer of healing, and I prayed them both sincerely and earnestly. And I know that God will answer those prayers according to his great and good plans. And if that doesn't include healing for Ben, then praise be to the Lord God Almighty, our loving Heavenly Father. It doesn't stop me from praying that. Doesn't stop us from praying that. Doesn't stop us from praying for healing for loved ones, if it's back issues, if it's cancer, if it's relationship struggles, if it's anxiety, whatever it might be. We ought to earnestly pray for people, focusing on the most significant, namely their spiritual health and the spiritual health of other people through them, but also praying for areas of need, trusting that the Lord will answer according to his great and good purposes. So I hope that's just sort of, I mean, it's been a pleasure actually to talk through some extra things about prayer, but I hope there's some encouragement there, and may we pray boldly. You know, I don't think that, I don't think it's good if our prayers are completely vague and we keep on saying, the Lord Jesus, when he was when he was in great anguish in the Garden of Gethsemane, he actually used some words after his prayers. He actually prayed, Lord or Father, deliver me from the cup that is before me, but not my will, but your will. And that's Jesus praying earnestly and specifically for something and acknowledging, but you know, I want to be completely, implicitly faithful to you. So you do what you want to. This is what I'm asking, but you do as you want. And There's complexities to understand why Jesus would pray like that, but you know, I think we ought to pray specifically for God honoring big things. Let's make sure that our prayer doesn't just sit in matters of health and comfort, but let's pray for massive fruitfulness as followers of Jesus. And let's pray for our church, that our church loves the people in the church, just grow in the love of the Lord Jesus and make a difference to further the kingdom in astonishing ways. Let's pray that, and let's be bold and let's be eager in love growing for each of us as we're prayerfully asking for those big things. So that's just unpacking a bit about prayer. Here's the next question. The radical transformation of salvation that we saw and heard in Ben's testimony in baptism is clearly God's work. Is it possible, however, that salvation could take place over a long period of time? I encourage you to go back and look, it's on YouTube, to look and listen to Ben's testimony. And you can do that and you'll hear, yes, God put his hand upon Ben. Most often when somebody becomes a Christian, it's because a Christian has journeyed with them, sharing verbally the truth of God. But do you know what? God has all sorts of ways of doing it. Sometimes God just uses his word with no person involved, no person speaking the truth, just people pick up a tract, just pick up the Bible, just do it all by themselves. And Ben was an example of that. And I say, praise be to God. Even though I know that most times that God uses you and me, he uses people to witness, to share God's truth, to give a word in season, to reason, like the Apostle Paul. He reasoned and explained the gospel, and he quoted poets, and he did all sorts of things. Found idols to unknown gods and used that as a cultural clutch to sort of be able to explain the gospel. He had all sorts of tricks. That's Acts 17 in Athens. He had all sorts of mechanisms and ways to explain the gospel, and lots of people became the Christian through him, and lots of people rejected Paul and tried to kill him, and probably did kill him in the end, to be honest, when Paul went to Rome. So there's lots of different ways that people can come to faith, and as a believer, I've got a responsibility to be faithful to God and to rejoice when God uses other people or other mechanisms, like people just picking up the Bible. And so it's just so encouraging. I rejoice in Ben's testimony because it just reminds me yet again that God is alive and well and active and present and fulfilling his purposes. And I just rejoice in that, and I'm motivated and encouraged to keep on helping people grow as followers of Jesus, and keep on growing myself as a follower of Jesus, and to keep us growing in evangelistic fervor, and putting it all together, God's kingdom is growing like the little mustard seed that becomes a nice big tree-like bush. And that's God's kingdom, keeps on growing, and God's got all sorts of mechanisms for that. So the radical transformation of salvation that we heard in Ben's testimony is clearly God's work. The last part of the question is it possible, however, that salvation could take place over a long period of time? Well, I think the short answer to that is salvation happens at a point in time. You come to trust in Jesus at a certain point in time. But sometimes it's really, really hard to pinpoint that. And, you know, many people have a testimony. I can remember becoming a Christian. I was young. I was six. I can remember the instant of trusting the Lord Jesus. And yet there's many people who just have this experience of growing in understanding and faith and can't actually pinpoint a particular time. There's nothing wrong with that, because the fruit of trusting in the Lord Jesus is clear, and we're just, but at some point there was a transition to faith in the Lord Jesus, and that's at a point of understanding of the gospel. So in the scriptures, Acts 16 as an example, Paul and Silas, after they've been singing hymns, after they've been beaten and bashed and singing hymns in prison, and there's the whole place shakes, and the jailer, who's just about to commit suicide, Paul cries out, stop, and the jailer says, what must I do to be saved? They're just absolutely, jailer's absolutely amazed, and Paul's answer is, believe and be saved. And that's how it is. We've got to come to the point of believe, and we will be saved as we believe. However, sanctification, so we become holy and a believer. Regenerate is the term that theologians use at that point of salvation. However, there is sanctification, the ongoing process of growing more like Jesus, and that will keep on happening. God's will is it keeps on happening every single day. And we grow and we progress as followers of Jesus. It's God's will that you be sanctified, and it's an ongoing, present, continuous, ongoing. 1 Thessalonians 4, verse 3. I'll read that out, actually. As for other matters, brothers and sisters, we instructed you how to live in order to please God, as in fact you are living. But now we ask you and urge you in the Lord Jesus to do this more and more, for you know what instruction we gave you by the authority of the Lord Jesus. It is God's will that you should be sanctified, that you should avoid sexual immorality, that each of you should learn to control your own body in a way that is holy and honorable. So this is Paul talking to Christians, and he's saying, journey in being like Jesus, in faithfulness, and putting, Paul uses language often about putting off the old self, put on the new self, and let's do that daily. Take off, put on. Make sure we take off the rubbishy stuff, the unholy stuff, to put on the holy stuff. And that's a process of becoming more like Jesus, sanctification. In Philippians 1 verse 6, well, I'll start reading a bit earlier than that, in verse 3, I thank my God every time I remember you. In all of my prayers and for all of you, I always pray with joy because of your partnership in the gospel from the first day until now, being confident of this, that he who began a good work in you will carry it on to completion until the day of Christ Jesus. That's sanctification, growing more like Jesus day by day. Hebrews 10 verses 11 to 14, day after day every priest stands and performs his religious duties. Again and again he offers the same sacrifices which can never take away sins. But when the priest had offered for all time, this priest, the Lord Jesus, he the one sacrifice for sins, Jesus on the cross, he then sat down at the right hand of God, and since that time he waits for his enemies to be made his footstool, for by one sacrifice he has made perfect forever those who are being made holy. That's a fascinating passage, and I just think, verse 14, for by one sacrifice he has made perfect forever those who are being made holy. And so we tie up a whole lot of these questions that we've looked at today that come together in this wonderful passage. We are saved through what Jesus has done, and there's a simple moment of trusting in the Lord Jesus that actually happens, but we are continuously made holy as a result of walking in step with God's Spirit and trusting the Lord Jesus and becoming more like Jesus. So I hope that there's some encouragement in the things that we've looked at together. We've had a bit of a whirlwind, we've covered lots of things, but isn't it great to be able to just sit back and talk and unpack the scriptures and to grow as followers of Jesus. And let's close with coming all the way back to the parable of that growing seed, that fruitful growing seed. Friends, that is the picture that the Lord Jesus himself gave to us. And that's our calling. That's our blessing. That's our privilege. That's how we can grow and minister now in ways that has eternal significance and implications for those who are saved and those who will be saved through us. And so for every single one that's listening to this, there's an implicit, urgent request from God himself. Request not strong enough. There's an implicit, urgent mandate to ensure that we are being fruitful followers of the Lord Jesus, because Jesus has saved us for our benefit and for us to benefit others. And so we're not realizing the enormous blessing that God has bestowed upon us if we are just keeping it to ourselves. So let's be growing as fruitful followers of the Lord Jesus. And for some of us, in fact, let's say for all of us, that's going to require us coming on our knees and saying, sorry for not living up to who I am and who you've made me to be as a follower of you, Lord Jesus. I say sorry. In fact, why don't I pray a prayer of repentance now? And I invite you to pray this with me. Dear Lord Jesus, as we've engaged yet again with these parables of growing seeds, and especially the parable of the sower, we do repent of the lack of fruit in our lives, where we've let weeds, the pleasures of this world, strangle us and stop us from being fruitful. Our eyes have moved away from the wonder and the joy of salvation. Lord, that does describe us, and I'm sorry to say that, but it does describe me. Lord, please forgive me. Please forgive us for losing sight of what you've saved us for. We rejoice afresh in what you have done, once and for all, sacrifice for sins forever. If sufficient to save all who call upon you for all time, we know that, and we trust you, and we worship you, and we honor you, and we rededicate ourselves to you, to love and serve you, to be growing in holiness, and to be growing in fruitfulness, that the fruit of the Spirit, Christ-likeness, blossom in us, and that life germinates in others as they see and hear and come to meet you through us. And so, Lord Jesus, we rededicate ourselves as your servants to be fruitful, to be healthy, to be obedient, to be loving, to be worshipful of you. And we pray these things in your precious name. Amen. Well, it's been a privilege to engage with you. May God bless you. May you grow. Thank you.